So let's start with 3 ohms first. We start with 3 ohms. Okay. So we begin with the maypole first. If you're sitting on a chair, please sit with your legs uncrossed, hands shaped like little bowls on your lap. And if you're sitting on the ground, Sukhasana is good. Let your spine be straight, erect. Take a deep breath and exhale. And let's take another deep breath and exhale. And another one. Imagine a golden circle on the ground around your feet. When you spread your hands sideways, perpendicular to the ground, that should be the radius of your circle. Now imagine a maypole in front of you with a golden globe at the top and different color ribbons hanging from it. Now imagine that you are getting up and walking up to the maypole and picking up a ribbon of the color of your choice today, any color. Take the ribbon and come back and sit down in your golden circle. In the golden globe, on top of the maypole, you can imagine a deity of your choice. Or if you do not believe in any form of God, you can imagine yourself. Or white light. And now let's ask the High Sea to send us down the maypole through the ribbon. Firstly, relaxing energy. So take in a deep breath, breathe in the relaxing energy and breathe out all stress, all tension, all anxiety which you may have accumulated in the last couple of weeks. Again, take a deep breath, breathe in the relaxing energy and breathe out all stress, all tension, all anxiety. Again, another deep breath. Imagine the relaxing energy coming down the ribbon and entering you and circulating in your entire body. And breathe out the stress, the tension, the anxiety. Now direct this relaxing energy to your entire body. So first, direct the relaxing energy to your feet. Imagine the relaxing energy covering your entire feet, your ankles, the soles of your feet, the heels, the fingers, and then coming up your legs, up your calf muscles, your shin bones, your knees, your thighs, your hips, and then your lower back, middle back, and upper back. Then imagine this relaxing energy coming down both your arms, up to your fingers. And then direct this relaxing energy to your abdominal area, your chest area, your neck, your entire head, the scalp of your head, your face and your throat. Relax. And now take a deep breath, breathe in the relaxing energy. Scrunch up your shoulders and bring them up to your ears. And then let go. As you breathe out, drop your shoulders with a sigh and allow the tension, the stress, the anxiety to roll off your shoulders. Let's do it again. Scrunch up your shoulders as you breathe in. And as you breathe out, relax and allow the tension to roll off. Again, for the last time, take a deep breath. And as you let go, with a big sigh, let your shoulders drop. And now let's ask the high sea to send us down the ribbon healing energy. If you like, you can imagine this healing energy coming down in the form of an emerald green light. So breathe in the healing energy and allow it to circulate in your entire body. And ask for physical, mental, and emotional healing which you need at this point of time. Again, take in a deep breath, breathe in the healing energy, and direct the healing energy to any part of your body wherein you feel discomfort or dis-ease or pain or stiffness. And allow that part to heal. And then breathe out. Again, take a deep breath. Breathe in the healing energy. And ask for the physical, mental, and emotional healing that you need at this point of time in your life. And now let us ask the High Sea to send us down the ribbon, cleansing and purifying energy. If you like, you can imagine this cleansing and purifying energy in the form of a white light. Just as we take a bath every day, now we are going to take an internal bath. So breathe in the cleansing and the purifying energy and imagine that you're being cleansed and purified internally. A lot of us accumulate a lot of tension, a lot of negativity when we deal with different situations and different people. And in all these interactions, we don't realize what we absorb. Very often what we absorb is not harmonious. It's not in sync with our frequency. So we need to cleanse ourselves and purify ourselves. So again, take in a deep breath. Breathe in the cleansing and the purifying energy. And breathe out all negative memories, negative feelings, and negative experiences which have bothered you, which have upset you. Again, take in a deep breath, breathe in the cleansing energy and ask the High Sea to cleanse every little bit of negativity that might be there in you. Another deep breath and ask that every negative thought, feeling, desire, emotion, judgment, opinion be cleansed and purified so that there is nothing in you which is less than divine. And now let us ask the High Sea to send us down the ribbon strengthening energy. So take in a deep breath, breathe in the strengthening energy and breathe out any weakness which you are ready to release at this point of time in your life. Again, take another deep breath, breathe in the strengthening energy and ask for mental, emotional and physical strength to deal with the challenges that life is throwing up for you now. Another deep breath and breathe in the strengthening energy and ask for all the strength that you need now. And now, let us ask the High Sea to send us down the ribbon unconditional love. If you like, you can imagine this unconditional love coming down the ribbon in the form of pink light. So take a deep breath, breathe in this unconditional love and breathe out any aspect of yourself which might resist taking in this unconditional love from the High Sea. Unconditional love is what all of us look for all our lives. We look for it in relationships and we never get it. So let's take this unconditional love from the High Sea. Again, another deep breath. Breathe in this unconditional love and exhale. Just as a glass gets filled with water from the bottom to the top, imagine that this unconditional love is being poured onto you like a waterfall. It's cascading all over you, all around you, and you're drenched in it. Imagine that this unconditional love is being poured into you. And you are getting filled with this unconditional love from your feet upwards. Slowly but steadily, allow this unconditional love to fill you completely. Allow this unconditional love to go into all the dark spaces which you have created for yourself. Allow the unconditional love to go into every nook and corner of your being which you have closed because you were hurt. Allow the unconditional love to fill your entire being. Allow it to wash away the shadows in you. Allow the unconditional love to fill up to the top of your head and then allow it to overflow. Imagine a sphere around yourself and allow this unconditional love which is overflowing to fill that sphere completely. And when the sphere is filled, you are submerged, you are drowned in this unconditional love. And now imagine a flower in your heart, any flower of your choice, any color of your choice. Check and see whether the flower is like a bud, or it is half blossomed or completely blossomed. Very often, when we interact with people in different situations and when we get hurt, we close our hearts to love. So today, let's open up again to love. Take a deep breath and breathe in the unconditional love from the high sea and direct it towards this flower in your heart. And allow the flower to blossom. Just as a sunflower gets up in the morning and blossoms in sunlight, watch every petal unfurl. Petal by petal, watch each part of the flower blossom in this unconditional love from the high sea. And soak in this unconditional love like a sponge. When we share this unconditional love with others, it flows like a stream. And when we don't share it, it stagnates like water in a pond. So let's share this unconditional love with different groups of people across the world. So join your hands in Namaste and point it in front of you. And underneath the maypole, imagine one by one, just for a couple of seconds each one of your family members in front of you. Parents, spouse, children, siblings. And direct this unconditional love towards them. Just for a few moments each. And now let's direct this unconditional love towards people whom we don't like. People who have hurt us, who have created many difficulties in our lives, could be personal, could be professional. Let's imagine these people in underneath the maypole and direct this unconditional love to them. Had they known better, had they had love in their hearts, probably they would not have behaved the way they did. Take a deep breath, breathe in the unconditional love. Imagine it coming down the ribbon into you, out through your hands, towards these people. And now let's direct this unconditional love to groups of people who need this. Could be sick people in hospitals, could be orphans, could be the elderly in old age homes, could be refugees in any country. Whatever comes to your mind, please direct this unconditional love towards them. Now let's imagine our country, India. If you're comfortable, you can imagine the map of India and direct this unconditional love towards the entire country, all its people and all the leaders, so that they can take the country on the right path. And now lastly, let's imagine the whole world, Mother Earth. If you like, you can imagine the whole globe and direct this unconditional love to Mother Earth with a lot of gratitude for all that she has given us, to all the countries, all the people in the world, and all the leaders. And whenever you're done, you can thank the high sea and slowly open your eyes. So the subject which we are going to deal with today is called projections. Phyllis always said that all the time we are projecting something or the other onto others. So what exactly is a projection? I will take you through what exactly is a projection, what it means and how we project onto others. And how others project onto us, both ways. So projection is like a defense mechanism. It's a defense mechanism which helps us to cope with certain feelings and emotions that we have trouble in accepting in ourselves. So primarily most of these are negative. So for example, if I have a negative feeling in me, and I don't want to acknowledge it or accept it or come to terms with it, it's easy to project it onto somebody else and say that person has that feeling. And I will now explain to you in more detail. Projection is basically called a Freudian projection. It was coined by Sigmund Freud, and therefore it's called a Freudian projection. And projection happens, according to Freud, when there is a psychological conflict between our unconscious feelings, negative feelings, and between our conscious beliefs about ourselves. So I may believe that I'm a very nice person, a very good person, a very well-meaning person, but I may have a negative feeling which I'm not willing to acknowledge. So that's when projection happens, because in order to subdue this kind of an internal conflict which takes place, then we attribute these negative feelings to somebody else. It's very easy to project onto others, because when we project onto others, we refuse to take responsibility for our negative feelings. It's very easy to say, I am okay and the others are not okay. It's that kind of space that we get into. We basically trick ourselves into believing that the whole world is wrong, but I am right. I can't think negatively. I'm a very nice person. So we need to be very careful of what we are projecting onto others. Now let's take a look at what is it that we project onto others. What kind of things we project onto others? We project anger. We project fear. We project resentment. We project dislike of other people. Sometimes we project guilt. Sometimes when we are dissatisfied with our own life, we project dissatisfaction. Sometimes when we are perfectionists, we project that perfectionism also onto others. And we also project different kinds of needs. The most important and basic need which all of us, almost all of us, project onto others is the need for love. We project this need onto our spouses, and we project this need onto our children. We also expect this from our parents. Some of us get it, some of us don't. We project our need for approval onto others, our need for support, our need for validation of our work or whatever we do. When we are constantly looking for validation, we are projecting that onto others. Recognition and appreciation also. We keep projecting this onto others. We are constantly, these are basically what I've just mentioned, these are those needs from childhood which were not met during our childhood when we were being brought up. And because these are unmet needs, we are still seeking them from others, from outside. And so when we don't get them, we project them onto others. To give you, now I'll come across a couple of examples which I thought I'll share with you. There are people who constantly think negatively about themselves. So they assume that others also think negatively about me. If I think negatively about myself, I assume that others are also thinking negatively about me. So if somebody cracks a joke, I can't take it. If somebody pulls my leg, I can't take it. I'm very bad at taking jokes. So what is this? This is nothing but a projection of my own feelings of inadequacy onto others. So we often find this in children, where we have in a class, you'll have children who are very bindas and happy-go-lucky, but you have children who are very serious about everything. They simply can't take a joke. And they start crying when somebody pulls their leg or this. And then they carry this in adulthood also. So we need to take a look at this, that do we have the habit of doing this? And if we are, then what are we projecting? Is it a feeling of inadequacy? Is it negative thinking about ourselves? We need to take a look. Sometimes we project our own negative qualities or habits which we dislike onto others. If I dislike a habit of laziness in myself, I will call the other person's lazy. I will say he is a lazy bum, she is a lazy bum, and doesn't do this, doesn't do that, not realizing that probably on some scale, on 1 to 10, that habit may not be on 10, but it may be there somewhere in us, and we dislike that habit in ourselves, but we project it onto others. Feedback from family is one of the best ways to check these habits. The most difficult, but one of the best ways. So, if you are in the habit of discussing these things with your family, maybe that's a good way of getting a good feedback. Now, we find, and particularly because I'm in the police, we find a large number of men suspecting their wives of infidelity. Now, the wife would never even dream of being unfaithful, but the husband suspects her, and there's no reason for his suspicion. Why that happens is the husband is attracted to another woman. He is the one who is actually guilty, but he would like to project this onto the wife and say that she is guilty of infidelity. And this is something which we find is very common. It is nothing but a projection. And of course, the same happens with women, but we find that it is more with men. So, what's happening with the man is his inner values actually tell him this is unacceptable, but he's attracted to another woman. He can't help it. And so he projects it onto the wife. Yeah. Another way in which we project is that supposing we look at the mirror in the morning and there's something about our face or body that we don't like. Either my hair has turned white or I've got pimples or I've grown fat, I've put 1 inch extra here or 1 inch extra there. There's something about myself which I don't like. So these are body image issues. Okay. The moment you see a fat lady or a fat man, you criticize. He's fat, he should take care of himself, or she's grown like this, she should take care of herself. So what you're doing is, the body image issues which we ourselves have, we are projecting onto others. And this is something which, when we take a look at ourselves in the mirror every day, how much of yourself are you able to love is something which you need to take a look at. So what happens is, the flaw which is there in yourself, you're not willing to accept it and you project it onto others and criticize them for it. Same thing we do with behavior of other people. Supposing we are unconscious sometimes of our behavior with others. We may be a little snappy at times, we may be a little peevish at times, but we are unconscious about it. But when somebody else is snappy or peevish at a dinner table or while talking to you, you're very quick to notice it and realize that, yes, that's a quality which I don't like. Take a look back and see whether you are being peevish or snappy yourself. A very common kind of projection is when we dislike others and we are not willing to accept it. So we feel that others dislike us. He doesn't like me, so I don't want to talk to him. I don't want to have anything to do with him because I'm getting very negative vibes from him. But the truth is that the dislike lies in you. Again, you are projecting it onto others. So this is something which is very, very common. We don't want to accept the fact that we are capable of disliking others. Because again, as I said, we all have a very nice self-image about ourselves. Several people project their insecurities and vulnerabilities onto others. We find in school, for example, if a boy is very insecure and vulnerable, he will pick up on another boy who is insecure and vulnerable and bully him. So bullying, we find in schools, whether it's girls or boys, is a very common way of projecting one's own insecurities and vulnerabilities onto others. Similarly, we find that in relationships, very often between couples, we find that one person is clinging on to the other and is very needy. Could be a wife, could be a husband. This is again another projection of insecurity and vulnerability. They want to hold on to a person because they are insecure and vulnerable from inside. We find for a large number of people who come to us with issues where the husband is highly abusive, or recently I came across a very senior police officer whose wife has been abusing him for the last 20 years. She is violent and she has a serious psychiatric disorder, but the man refuses to walk out on her, refuses to get rid of that abuse for the simple reason because as he was growing up as a child, he grew up with a lot of insecurity and vulnerability, and now this abuse has become his comfort zone. So he does not want to walk out. So are we very clinging and needy in our relationships, particularly with a spouse, is something which we definitely need to take a look at. Okay. Then we find that those children who have had, whose needs for love, nourishment, affection, pampering during childhood have not been fulfilled, and if they have had a parent, any parent, either father or mother, who basically has become very abusive, and later on the abuse reduces, even then we find that these children have lot of issues at lunchtime or dinner time, particularly when they are eating. So if the child is very fussy while eating, if the child is constantly dissatisfied with food, constantly wants something else or is not happy with the food that is being given, then one needs to take a look at what is the child projecting. This is very, very important. Phyllis gave the example of one couple who had come to her. This boy had lost his father when he was very young, maybe around 10 or 12 years old. And when he lost his father and he had a couple of siblings, so his mother depended on him mentally and emotionally initially, and later on when he was old enough to work, then they all depended on him for running the household. So the entire burden of running the household became very strong, and he could not handle that. It was very difficult for him to handle this, and so every time he would get close to a girlfriend and be in a relationship, the moment she would talk about commitment, he would withdraw. Because for him, commitment meant a huge responsibility, and he was tired of responsibility. So we often find in relationships that men or women, anybody who is afraid to commit, there would be a certain reason behind it. So it could be a projection. Projection could probably be one reason. And when he finally got married, the moment his wife started talking about having a child, he actually divorced her. Because he was not willing to take up the responsibility of having a child and committing himself to another project for next 20 years. So very often we find that partners who are afraid of commitment, they project it onto the other partner and blame the other partner for the relationship not working out. So this is again another thing which we will need to take a look at. Very often, if we are jealous or envious of others, take a look at whether you feel that the others are jealous or envious. If you're constantly feeling that somebody else in your life is very jealous or envious of you, then take a look at where you stand in terms of jealousy and envy. It could also be a projection. It could also be because one has not got enough recognition and appreciation during childhood. So take a look at both. Very often parents tell their kids, don't do this, otherwise this will happen. Don't do this, otherwise this will happen. We've seen people where the children are very interested in adventure sports, but the parents will hold them back. No, you can't jump into water because you will drown. You can't do this because this will happen, etc., etc., etc. So parents might have had their own experiences. The habit of projecting fears onto children is very common. So take a look at, if you have children, take a look at whether you are projecting some kind of a fear onto your child, and are you holding your child back from doing something? Sometimes we are afraid that the child will fail, and sometimes it is just purely a projection of our own fears. We also project our anger onto others. Sometimes we get angry at small things. Sometimes we just blast off over a very small thing. If you find that you are just getting annoyed and irritated with small things and totally exploding, and it's a very knee-jerk kind of a reaction, you definitely need to take a look at what anger are you releasing, or what anger are you projecting onto others. The root cause may be something else. It may be a lot of deep-seated anger in you. It may be a dissatisfaction with certain things in you. It may be a sense of perfectionism in you. The root cause may be anything. But you, if you're projecting this onto others, then one has to take a look at it. Sometimes you feel that the other person is angry. Again, that's a projection. Take a look at whether the other person is really angry, or are you projecting onto the other person. You may just be upset with yourself at times. If you are attracting angry people into your life, you definitely need to take a look at anger within you. If there are angry people around you, if you are attracting an angry coworker or an angry subordinate, then that's probably a signal that there must be anger somewhere in you.
So how does this work? Suppose we come across a crazy person. Whatever, they could be mentally ill.
Maybe so karma. Maybe karma could be looked at. Some karma which needs to be handled. Or maybe it calls for more patience in us. Maybe that's what creation is teaching us. I think these two things we could take a look at. Yes, the tie which has to be cut is the tie of karma with that person. Then you will that causes a great shift. Actually, it causes a big relief, cutting the ties of karma with that person.
And when you're talking about projections, so if parents are projecting onto us their fears or any other negative habits, then we can cut ties with those.
Yeah, I'll come to the ties. I'm coming towards the end. Once I explain all the concepts, then I come to the ties at the end, and we can discuss what more ties can be cut. Sometimes parents fail to achieve something in life. For example, let's say a sports person or somebody wanted to climb Mount Everest and he was not able to do it. Now he wants his child to do it, to fulfill that which he could not do. This is called a projection of failure. So one needs to take a look at what is it that our parents push us into doing at times just because they wanted to achieve that in life and they could not. Similarly, there are some parents who like to project their achievements. If this happens very often with super achiever parents who have achieved a lot and much more beyond a normal person, and they want their child also to excel naturally, but then they push their child really extra hard into doing something which the child probably is not inclined to do. So parents very often project not just failure but also achievement. So one needs to take a look at what are we projecting onto our children. Also take a look at when you are, if you are working with colleagues and subordinates who are constantly seeking your approval and you're getting annoyed with it, that why is this person constantly seeking my approval and recognition? Like for example, we have in the forces, initially when we got into the job, we would find that a lot of people are very particular about rewards, that for every small thing achieved, they want a reward. So on one hand, while we realized that probably that was because of their unmet need for recognition and appreciation, but we all had to look inside to see that somewhere inside, are we also seeking approval and recognition? So that was like a signal from the others. Awareness of all these projections leads to a greater level of freedom, inner freedom and independence of all this. If you find that couples are fighting and are not getting along, if both are aware about the cutting ties work, then they definitely need to take a look at what are they projecting onto each other. Not just unmet needs of childhood, but what are they projecting onto each other. It's very, very important. So as I mentioned earlier, if you are overreacting to something, if you have a knee-jerk reaction to something, if you're suddenly reacting to something and you're getting angry, irritated, annoyed, or you're feeling guilty, for example, then you need to take a look at what are you projecting onto others. And if you become aware that this is what I'm projecting onto others, then it's very important at that point of time not to react. The first thing is not to react. Check issues in your body, whether you're getting a headache, whether you're getting, whether you're having digestive issues, whether you're having issues in the neck, whether you're having, let us say, knee pains, whether you're having backaches. Just check at that point of time when you're having this knee-jerk reaction, is your body also physically reacting or not? That's very important. Insomnia, muscle pains, shoulder aches, some kind of spasm, some kind of cramps may also indicate a projection on your part. Projection basically makes you feel superior to others because it allows you to overlook your own faults and inadequacies. And we believe that the others have all these faults and inadequacies. We fail to see the good in other people when we project, because we are always looking at others rather than looking at our own flaws. So what happens is we refuse to take responsibility for our own flaws and we refuse to correct them. It's very easy to blame others for what we are feeling, what we are thinking and what we are saying. So what's very important is avoid and acting and reacting and speaking out when you are projecting. And if you are stressed out, at that point of time, it's better to remain absolutely quiet. Because that's the time, it's in the times of stress that we project. So you have to be very mindful. When you're having a reaction, you have to be very mindful. When others project onto us, you suddenly feel, what is this nonsense? I mean, this is totally untrue. what is he saying or what is she saying? You feel that it's totally untrue. You may actually be accused of those things which the other person has, of those feelings, those emotions which the other person has, and you know it, that this person, this is how he behaves, this is how he feels. So it's like a complete reversal of truth which is being projected onto you. So there are just two things which you need to do at that point of time. You just have to disengage internally. Just have to tell yourself, this is not about me, this is about him. Or this is about her. Disengage, that is like saying detach immediately from the situation. Do not explain, defend, don't go on the defensive, don't try to argue, don't try to teach or sermonize to him or her. At that point of time, he is not in a space to take this from you. Don't analyze, don't counterattack, don't criticize. If you do all this, they win. So the idea is to keep absolutely quiet about this. So around this, a couple of cuts which we have identified, and then we can discuss further on this subject. So one is a general habit of projecting our needs onto others. So if we are not able to specifically identify within ourselves what is it that we are projecting, then you could do a general cut. That is the habit of projecting my needs onto others. A very important cut is the habit of projecting my need for love onto my partner. Irrespective of whether you're in a happy or an unhappy relationship, this is a cut which really frees you from a need. So, habit of projecting my need for love onto my partner and its effect on me. A couple of other cuts are habit of projecting my need for support and validation onto others and its effect on me. Habit of projecting my need for approval onto others. Yeah. Habit of projecting my need for support and validation onto others and its effect on me. Similarly, approval. Similarly, recognition and appreciation. Similarly, fears. If you're in the habit of projecting your fears onto others, particularly siblings, colleagues, children, partners. Similarly, anger. If you're in the habit of projecting anger onto others. And when we project anger onto others, we always find an excuse to say that the other person is responsible for my anger. He did this or he said this, or he or she didn't do this or said this, that's why I am angry. So we shift the blame onto others. So the habit of projecting my anger onto others and its effect on me. And the habit of projecting my need for perfectionism onto others. And it's a need on me. If you think that you are a perfectionist and that is a problem, then I hope you have cut ties with that. If you haven't, then you could do this. Habit of projecting my need for perfectionism onto others. So, any questions on this so far? Yeah. Recognition, appreciation, approval.
Let's say a quality like anger, if we have cut ties with the quality itself, will there still be the tendency to project if we have already
cut? Yes, because qualities like anger, fear, one cut is not enough. So there are many reasons for it. A root cause of anger could be different, but then over a period of time, let's say the root cause of anger is somewhere from your childhood. While you have cut ties with the root cause of anger, but as you have grown up, you have made anger into a habit. As an expression of emotion, you have made it into a habit, so therefore it has to be cut. Yeah.
Another one is about stress. Whether stress, when we are experiencing stress, whether it could be the projection of, it itself is a consequence of a projection from outside, or it is something from within.
I think stress is primarily something from within. So one needs to sit and identify that what is it that you're stressed out with. Just to give you an example, I have a colleague who has very high expectations from his subordinates who are working with him in office. Now, there are many people of different kinds of abilities who come to work for us. And very often, and this was something which Phyllis herself had to cut ties with, it is intolerance of other people's lesser mental abilities. And for most of us at workplace, this is a challenge. Because the kind of work, even if you're a housewife at home, and let us say you have maids coming and working for you, it will be an issue because what you want them to do and what they are capable of doing is something different. So whether it's workplace, home, there are times when a child is not very intelligent and we keep pushing that child much beyond what he or she is capable of, hoping that they will do better. So is it an intolerance of others' lesser mental abilities? That is one thing which we will need to check. And yes, stress, there are innumerable factors for stress. So that is something which we will need to check because it is primarily internal. Yeah. Environment definitely gets stressful. If you're working in a very stressful environment, a very demanding kind of a job, then yes, that adds to your ability or inability to handle stress.
Charu, I have a question regarding projection of failures. Isn't it? No, what I felt is if an illiterate mother wants her children to be educated, so it is a, is that a wrong?
No, I think that's fine.
That's fine. Yeah. So projection of failures is always not wrong, isn't it?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, but that may not be a projection for failure. It may be a desire for a good life.
There's a difference.
A projection of failure is if I, as I mentioned, I want to climb Mount Everest, I could not do it, so now I push my child that you have to climb Mount Everest.
Okay.
Thank you. That's a projection of failure. If I want to be a musician, a guitarist, and I was never able to do it, I will buy a guitar to my child and hand him and tell him, you have to play the guitar.
Okay, yeah. One thing I again want to ask you, because when I was a child, I was never, my parents did not buy toys for me. So I had a great desire for toys, and when Radhika Nitika was small, I had filled the room with toys. So I don't know whether I did
the right thing or wrong thing.
And I used to also enjoy with the toys. Yeah,
you're just pampering them the way you would have liked to be pampered.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, thank you.
My daughter is 8 years, and we are living currently in Frankfurt, and she sees her classmates wearing skirts which are just above. So yesterday also when I went for shopping, she wanted to buy. I was like, no, this is not decent. I was like little, so she was like, I want, and I was very, no, this is not decent. And now I went hearing, am I projecting something on her, or was I right or wrong?
So we all come from different backgrounds, different cultures, and these cultures delineate a lot of do's and don'ts. So when you come from a different culture and you're living in a different culture, it's going to be difficult for you to accept certain norms. So you will have to take a look at what you are projecting. Are you projecting your own cultural values? and how do you want her to be? Because this is a challenge for every Indian family which goes abroad, whether it's America or any other country, and you're suddenly living in a different culture. Then how is it that you would like your children to be? How do you want, what kind of clothes do you want them to wear? What kind of company do you want them to be in? That is something which is quite a challenge for you. So maybe you're projecting your cultural values. If it's a 17, 18 year old girl who's wearing short skirts, would you have objection then? Or would you have an objection to an 8 year old wearing short skirts? You'll have to take a call on that.
I feel she's small, so it is my duty to tell her what is the thing.
So are you sure that what you're telling her is absolutely right?
Yes.
In a German context? You're living in Germany now. You have to take a call. As a parent, you have to take a call.
Okay. Thank you. Yes. All her classmates wear in the summer, so, and she also wishes to wear. And I'm telling her that is not decent like that. I don't know more what else to explain her more than that.
So we find that, this is a thought, we find that very often abroad girls are more comfortable with their bodies. In India, we would like to wrap ourselves around completely because that's decency. So what is the definition of decency and indecency? That we will have to take a call. Yeah. In fact, if somebody even told me to wear a swimsuit today, I won't. I wear a full bodysuit. I can't wear something which is short. Why? Because that's my conditioning and that's how I'm comfortable in. So would you like to be your daughter to be comfortable with her body? That call you will have to take.
Sai Ram. So Charu, when you're talking about projection, so I think there's a little bit of confusion because there are two aspects to it. So one thing is expectation. So one is, for example, in her example, where she would, you know, expect her daughter to wear dresses in a certain way. And the other side is, you know, the kind of projection that probably we would have faced. For example, in my case, my father during childhood would always project on me, and even till today, that, you know, I can't do this, I can't do that, or, you know, don't let her handle it, it will all go wrong, something like that. And what happens is, that is his belief. And then when now I do not get impacted after all the cutting ties work, but initially whenever I would be with him, I would really prove him right. So that's getting projected on me.
You were playing out your conditioning.
So it's because he's thinking like that about me. It's because of his thoughts that are so strong, his belief is so strong. And maybe I'm not strong enough to take it. So if I drive with him, maybe I'll make a mistake while driving. So so I think, are these both expectations?
Yeah,
also,
so they're very
categorizing.
So I think before we all started, I asked everybody if they've done the babushka or not. So have you done the babushka? Right. So have you cut ties with all this which your father constantly kept repeating to you in childhood, that you can't do this or you shouldn't do this?
That was the roles.
No, the roles is different. That's okay. The balloon. Babushka is the different layers of conditioning. So now conditioning is what your parents keep repeating to you very often. About what is it that you cannot do or should do, or what is it that you are. For example, you're not beautiful enough. For example, you're not intelligent enough. You will never be able to do this because you're not intelligent enough. So negative conditioning is what we handle with in babushka. Projection is your father's projection of his own failure or fear or achievement. So if he is afraid, let's say as a child, he almost drowned in water and now he will not allow his child to swim because he's afraid, he has a fear of water. So his fear of water, he's projecting onto you. So that is what a projection is. So that's why I asked very clearly, because once you understand what a role is, once you understand what babushka is, then it's clearer and you will be better able to understand what a projection is.
Thank you.
That projection
So you cut ties with the your father projecting his fear onto you. Yeah. Effect of your father projecting his fear of whatever, failure, drowning, whatever, onto you.
And if we don't know if it is exactly the fear.
Something, yeah, if it's a general, no, then you will have to dig deeper. Because you can't, while you can cut ties with your habit of projecting onto others, but you can't cut ties with the whole world projecting onto you because you don't know what it is. So regarding that, you will have to dig a little deeper and see what it was. If sometimes parents project their dissatisfaction about life onto children. Dissatisfaction, annoyance, irritation, blame, guilt, whatever. They may project. So take a look at whether your parents were, was there any dissatisfaction for any reason? And was that what they were projecting? That we'll have to take a look.
Then what's the difference between projection and motivation, motivating a child to, you know, give his best? Like, you know.
So that's a positive stroke, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So you, projection is holding back.
Yeah. You're able to see the child's potential in a very, whatever way you're able to assess it, but the child is not ready to put in the effort which is needed for him to achieve. It's not about my projection of what I want him to do, but then there is a basic assessment which we can make with his nature and, you know, his interest and things like that.
And you may feel that the child is not putting enough hard work.
Yeah, yeah. If he can do that, he can really achieve whatever he wants to achieve. Hmm. So how do we go about this? Then will that become again a projection, or how do we
handle? That you will have to check internally to see whether you're projecting onto him your ambition for him. Dig a little deeper.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Yeah. Should we move on to the next subject? Yeah, please.
Charu, can you elaborate more on the projection of dissatisfaction? Can you give an example of how do you project, you know, dissatisfaction onto others?
So we find that, let us say, a lady in her middle age has been very, very dissatisfied with her marriage, the fact that she was not allowed to take up a career, and she was just told that you've got to be a housewife, you've got to marry, have a family, etc. And so by middle age, by the time she crosses 40, 45, that dissatisfaction starts catching up with her when she sees other people around her achieving more or doing a lot more than, and she feels that she would have liked to do it. So then there is constant dissatisfaction, constant cribbing, etc. And she may have this tendency of projecting this onto her husband. Or she may have the tendency to project this onto her children by being dissatisfied with whatever they are doing. She's irritated with what husband is doing. She's irritated with what the maid is doing. She's irritated with what the child is doing. So why is she so unhappy and what is she projecting? So maybe that could be an example.
Okay, thank you.
So can we move on to the next subject? Yeah. So we come to the subject of family atmospheres. And this particular family atmosphere we're going to talk about today is around communication. So the family atmosphere is the atmosphere in which all of us grow up. Each parent brings a different family atmosphere into the home. So the mother will bring a different atmosphere and the father will bring a different atmosphere. And then they create a new family atmosphere in their home. This is the atmosphere in which children grow up. This is the atmosphere in which children learn how to look at the world. Now, what primarily happens is that since all of us are different people, all these atmospheres become very different at home. It's almost, I would say, it's like a khichdi at home. And the family atmospheres revolve around different subjects. right from time, food, money, energy, could be sex, could be religion. There are almost 15-20 different subjects around which these family atmospheres revolve. So, to give you a small example, so let us say in a family there may be a parent who is very punctual and a parent who may be completely non-punctual. So, the children who grow up, they either copy one of the parents or they oscillate between both the parents. Sometimes they are very punctual, sometimes they are very unpunctual. Now, coming to communication, Phyllis always said that the root cause of all the problems in the world is lack of a proper communication. So, if you actually take a look at entire history, if you take a look at all the problems within nations and between nations, the root cause is what is communicated. Now, when the missing ingredient which has always been spoken about in all relationships is communication. Very open, honest, and very frank communication. So, one of the exercises which somebody suggested was that in every Sunday, if a family could sit together and talk about how the week went by. Talk about different things which they liked during the week or which they did not like. Could be at school or at workplace or could be about each other. That mummy, last week you scolded me for this and I was very hurt. I cried the whole night but I didn't tell you about it. So the mother comes to know what hurt the child. Similarly, the child can be told by the parent that this is what you did and I thought you were very disrespectful and very disobedient and maybe this can be avoided in future. So this is one of the ideas, and in fact we find it very helpful because now I'm working for a force where the men stay away from their families. So I'm working with the CRPF now, and in the CRPF out of 35 years which a man works in CRPF, almost 30 years he's away from the family. They stay in camps and they go for different operations. Now what happens is there's a complete breakdown of communication. So, and men and women, it's not very easy for them to actually share with strangers about what is happening at home. So if I suddenly put 20 people in a room who don't know each other, they're not going to open up about their personal lives and talk about it openly. So we started this concept of, we call it circle sharing. And we started this concept every Sunday where 20 men in small groups gather together and talk about what has happened in the last 1 week personally and professionally. And within 3 months, we found that those boys who were never opening up, who would remain confined to their barracks and not share with others, they've now started sharing, and a new kind of bonding and camaraderie is developing in these camps, which was not there earlier. And this is a wonderful exercise which has been prescribed even for families. It really breaks down barriers in communication. So if it is something which has not been done so far, maybe you could try your hand at it. So when children come from a background where the parents have not had a very free-flowing communication, the child either tends to withdraw and communicate very less, or the child tends to become very angry or violent. So one needs to take a look at whether your child is communicating correctly, appropriately, frankly, freely or not. If not, then one needs to take a look at what is going on in the mind of the child. Now, very often when the father figure in the family is very powerful, very authoritative, and very serious, and creates fear, then the children are not confident in their communication. And I'm very sure in most of our families, particularly the elder generations of grandparents and all, there have been such authoritative figures who would be so authoritarian that their children would really not learn to open up very frankly and freely. So one needs to understand this. When the child is afraid of the father and not confident about opening up, they turn towards the mother. Supposing the mother, because of the father's authoritarian attitude and because of the stress and strain in the family, has a burnout syndrome. Phyllis used to call it a burnout syndrome, where the mother is tired. She's tired of everything because of running the family, the relationships, the stress, etc. If she has had a burnout syndrome, then she does not communicate with the child either. So the child runs to her, but the mother turns the child away. And then what is the child left with? So the child does not learn to communicate. The child either becomes very shy, does not make many friends because the child does not know how to communicate. Or the child becomes very afraid and very diffident. So around you'll have many such examples of children, of grown-up adults who are either shy, who are diffident, who are afraid. Maybe the reason is a difficult communication pattern at home. This is what one could, Very often when such children later on get into relationships, let us say it's a boy who is shy, afraid, diffident, not clear in communication, they have the tendency to attract women who are very powerful and authoritarian in relationships and who are very dominating. So you'll find that somewhere the child is again attracting the same pattern, attracting a partner similar to the father figure. So that's an interesting thing to take a look at. So what needs to be done is to ask for a symbol for this pattern of communication and then cut ties with that. Very often, if children or adults have a constant problem with the throat, that's an indication of communication issues, where one needs to take a look at whether if the child is constantly getting a cough. There are some kids I find whose voice turns hoarse over a period of time because they're not able to communicate freely and openly. Then that's another indication that there are communication issues. Like these are things which you'll have to dig deeper. For example, if somebody asks me, do I have this issue? I'll say, no, I'm fine. I don't have this issue. So what are the things you need to look out for to be able to identify and understand these issues in yourself? That's what you need to watch out for. And so it depends on how old the child is. Again, if the child is over 14, then I would suggest that you teach the child the cutting ties work. Yeah, you definitely need to take a look at yourself and see if more open communication in the family definitely helps the child to open up.
As a mother, how can I help him to?
So one important exercise which Phyllis said is that when the child sleeps at night, you talk to the child and tell the child, reassure the child, and encourage the child that yes, you can talk to me at any point of time that you want to. And that exercise, the weekly exercise which I was saying, is very important. It's a beautiful exercise in opening up communication with the family.
There is a problem with the other parent, like father, and the mother is okay, the father is not, he is not okay with the father.
The mother can start the communication with the child. Whichever parent is open, the parent can start the communication and see how it goes.
That part we need not bother, what's happening.
Because one can't control the other person.
We can't do much about it.
Yeah.
Said about Phyllis Crystal's speaking to the child when kid is asleep or not?
Asleep. When the child sleeps at night, just when the child has gone to sleep, within maybe 10-15 minutes after that, the irrespective of whether the child has problems in communication or not, it's a very good exercise to reiterate to the child repeatedly how much you love the child and how much the child means to you and how you're looking forward to, you know, to this life with the child with a lot of joy, with a lot of happiness. So the idea is to nurture and nourish the child. And this message goes to the child's subconscious directly. Aloud, a little aloud, softly. Yeah.
Thank you.
That's a good one. Let's try it out. So wherever, as far as couples are concerned, wherever there are relationship issues as far as communication is concerned, then one needs to take a look at the communication patterns since childhood. That will really help understand each other better. If both of them are doing the cutting ties work, nothing like it. It can really be resolved very sweetly. Yeah. Again, sometimes when we find that parents either are abusive, or sometimes we find that one parent is alcoholic, or we find that somebody in the family is alcoholic, that also creates a lot of fear in the child. Again, it creates a lot of hesitance, and it makes the child hesitant to communicate freely and openly. So if this is a pattern, I mean, just take a look. If there is an issue in communication, just take a look at the family to see if alcoholism or any kind of addiction has been a pattern in the family. That helps to understand the child better. And what happens is these kind of addictions bring up a lot of shouting and screaming at home. And that affects the child very, very negatively. So let's say if one person is alcoholic and one person is very mild, then the child probably may oscillate between both the styles. Sometimes the child may copy one parent and sometimes the other parent, either alternately or maybe just one parent continuously. So you will find actually in families where there is alcohol addiction, you find that the children also get addicted to alcohol very fast. So again, that affects the styles of communication. All these kind of addictions create an entire atmosphere of impatience with the child. And the child learns impatience very fast in his life. Sometimes parents are in another room and the child is in another room, and the parents are constantly talking. The child subconsciously picks it up. So if the parents don't fight in front of the child but are arguing in the room, the child will pick up that communication and the child gets very deeply affected by it. That's why that exercise of talking to the child when the child is asleep, to assure the child that everything is all right. Even if has been an argument or a disagreement, assurance is very important to the child, because the child needs to understand that the parents love each other. That's the most important thing in the life of a child, for it to understand that everything is all right between the parents. When things go wrong between parents, it breaks the heart of the child first. So that's a very, very important. Very often, if let us say the father is and mother are arguing about something, the father is saying something, the mother is trying to convince him and the father is not listening. Okay, supposing the child is there and the child hears the mother constantly talking to the father and trying to convince the father, and the father is not agreeing. At other times, the child also hears the mother talking to the child also, that okay, you should do this, this is right, this is not right, let's not do it this way. After a period of time, the child hates it when somebody is trying to talk to him all the time. The child simply hates it if the teacher corrects him in class, The child hates it if a spouse, later on, the spouse tries to tell him, do this or don't do this. So what happens is when parents are communicating and the child understands it differently, or the child is not able to take it, the child does not like it when other people are trying to talk to the child. They hate it when other people are trying to advise the child, when other people are constantly trying to tell the child, you should do this, shouldn't do this, don't do this. Those do's and don'ts are something which the child hates, and then the child tends to rebel. So first thing is to correct ourselves, because as parents, naturally when you're bringing up the child, you would like to have a set of do's and don'ts in the household. Now the idea is that should you constantly be repeating and nagging the child about that, or setting these rules and then in your Sunday meetings, then you point out gently to the child. So there are parents who would like to tell the child the same thing every day. Over a period of time, the child gets fed up. So one needs to take a look at that. The child simply can't tolerate after some point of time and simply revolts. So one has to see. They don't want to be lectured to anymore. And they shut themselves. So then why take things to that extent where the child is shutting himself up? In some families, most of the time, when there are issues, the family members are not in the habit of sitting and talking and resolving the issues. They leave the issues to themselves to resolve. Again, I'll come back to this Sunday exercise. This helps resolve issues. If issues are left just like that, children replicate this in their marriage. And so the partner will say, okay, there's this issue, let's sit and talk. And this person will simply refuse to sit and talk about it. Why? Because that's what he has learned. He has learned that if there is an issue, you leave it. It will resolve by itself. And you often find this breakdown in communication between partners because of this issue, that partners are not willing to sit and talk about issues and resolve it. We have seen many couples where there's one partner who's really eager, who wants to talk and resolve. The other partner will say, there's no problem. And so this person is left thinking what's going wrong, and they can't get to the root of the issue. Then there's a breakdown in communication. Then they start sleeping in separate rooms, because that's another indication of a breakdown in communication. So one small thing leads to another. The basic root cause is lack of communication. Criticism is another form of communication which children don't take well. So again, the issue here is that how do you communicate criticism to a child? How do you communicate that there is a certain thing which you don't like in the child's behavior or studies or way of being or way of living? How do you communicate that to the child? Again, the Sunday exercise helps, where you can gently point out that this is what you did and this was not appropriate for this reason. Very often talking to a child very openly and sometimes like an adult helps, and children understand. A negative method of constantly criticizing the child does not go far. It really does not go far. It creates a lot of issues with the child as far as the child's own self-confidence is concerned and the child's own self-image is concerned, because in the process of building up his own personality and self-image, criticism from the parents constantly don't help in creating a positive self-image. So for communication, a very important exercise for all of us is the yin and the yang. I hope all of you are doing it on a daily basis. And the cosmic parents. The yang behavior, as you all know, is the assertive behavior. The speaking is yang, listening is yin. The even the acting out, the assertiveness, the aggressiveness, all that is yang. Very often, parents do not criticize a child openly, but just a glare, a stare, a look of disapproval is enough for the child to shrink back. So, are you open to studying the body language of your child? Do you watch the effect of your anger and disapproval on your child? Not just child, but again to everybody. Could be colleagues, that when you're angry and you're shouting and yelling, are you watching how your colleague is reacting? Are you watching the look of hurt on his face? When you're talking with a spouse, are we watching the reaction of the spouse to anger? And then are you correcting yourself, realizing that this is not the right expression? Can you check yourself at that point of time and then take it up at a later stage when you're not angry and talk to him or her in an even tone without putting a lot of emotion into what you're saying? It's very important to have an even communication without putting a lot of emotion into it. Very often when we show disapproval to a child, the child construes it as rejection. And that rejection then goes a long way, because then the child continuously attracts rejection in his or her life. They find friends who reject them, they find partners who reject them, and rejection becomes a habit. So one has to be very, very careful that when you are telling a child something, or even telling a child that you disapprove of a certain thing, you have to be very clear that you're not rejecting the child. The child needs to know that he or she is not rejected. When we are angry, most of the time we communicate from the space of the ego. So therefore, one has to be very careful in the expression of anger. A couple of cuts pertaining to this will be the family atmosphere around communication and its effect on you. And if you have copied one parent's style of communication, let's say one parent was very quiet and submissive and chose not to communicate at all, then have you copied that style of communication? And if one parent was aggressive, angry, and would explode every time there's an issue, then one needs to see whether you have copied that style of expression or not. Sometimes when we oscillate between two styles of communication, so if there are two opposite styles of communication of both parents, and if you're oscillating between both, then you need to cut ties with that also. Copying both parents alternately and its effect on you. Anger is always yang, and listening is always yin. So in your style of expression, which is more? That is one thing which we need to check in ourselves. If let us say somebody else is angry, how do we respond? Do we also react angrily? Or at that point of time, are you able to center yourself? And are you able to listen and then take up the issue and communicate later? So understand your own style of communication. If a person's style of communication centers around anger and is a very angry style of communication, it has to be from childhood. So one needs to understand that. If there are issues between spouses over communication, one exercise which is usually done is we make both the spouses sit together and write to each other what they would like to tell each other, and then read it out to each other. So if you know couples who have issues in communication and you would like to help them, maybe that if they're willing to do this, maybe this exercise will help in communicating. Very often when children drop into silence or you drop into silence because of certain methods of communication in the house, you need to take a look at what you are doing and whether that silence is helping or it's not helping. At that point of time, if there is a confrontation going on, silence may help. But if silence is a habit, then you will have to take a look at it. We often find in, I think, older generations, the women of the household would be silent. The grandmothers, great-grandmothers and all those people would be more silent. And this was always told to them that in order to maintain peace and harmony in the house, it's better to remain silent. So we find very often women to maintain peace and harmony dropping into silence. It's as if it's not the responsibility of the other gender. Very often kids have asthma. Those kids who have asthma, one needs to take a look at when that asthmatic attack is coming in, because asthmatic attacks come up very often when the child is feeling absolutely suffocated at home and communication is an issue, where either the child is watching the communication of the parents or the child is not able to communicate. So asthma is another, in asthma or bronchitis or in whatever forms, any issues with the throat and the lungs is often an indication of issues of communication.
A parent had it and it's inherited, then is it something that is biological, physical, or it would still have its root cause as psychological?
If you remember the mind-body connect, even if it's hereditary, maybe the family atmosphere was also similar. And that's what generated that. So one needs to take a look at that family atmosphere to see how the family, was there a lot of shouting, screaming at home where the child felt suffocated? We've seen children born into a house, born with asthma, where there has been a lot of shouting and screaming at home and the child grew up in that atmosphere. So one will have to take a look at how, even if it's hereditary, what was the family atmosphere in the grandparents or great-grandparents' home is what one needs to take a look at. Yeah. A very important point which came across, which Phyllis said, was that all of us have a very strong image of what a happy family life should be like. A happy family image. And so when a child is expressing something against that image, then the parents don't allow the child to express, or the parents don't allow each other to express anything which goes against that happy family image. So many of us have in our mind that my family is like this, like this, like this. Everything is fine, everything is perfect, everything is great, everything is good. Now the moment a child starts raising issues, the moment a child starts talking about this is not right, or this is not right, or you did not do this right, or you did not behave this way right, they don't allow the child to talk. So attachment to a happy family image, please take a look at whether that's bothering you and whether that is preventing open communication. So what happens is family sugarcoat very serious issues in the family. There may be, we've seen, there may be very severe issues of child sexual abuse in the family, but the family sugarcoats it. They don't want to talk about it because the family is perfect. The family is happy. Huh? This happened long time back when she was a child or he was a child. Everything is fine now, but they don't see the pain of the child because they would like to sugarcoat everything, and it's still a very happy family image. So one needs to take a look at this. Wherever there are relationships which are repeatedly failing, let us say a girl or a boy are getting into relationships, but the relationships are simply not working out. So one girlfriend or one boyfriend, two, three, four, and it's not leading to, let's say, a marriage or whatever, then communication needs to be checked. What are the reasons? Is the communication open? Are there certain fears underlying it? Etc. That has to be taken a look at. So please take a look at the pattern of communication which you have adopted and the pattern of communication in the family from which you have come. Okay? So, any questions on this?
So in one case that I know, if I'm just asking, so can the mother reassure the child in the sleep if the relationship between the parents is not harmonious also? Like if it's not completely harmonious and she's working to
get it going? She can reassure the child every night that irrespective of whatever differences are there between them, they still love the child.
And
irrespective of the differences, they still love the child. The child means a lot. The child has brought a lot of happiness in their lives, and they will always continue to love the child.
And in her case, if supposedly she wants to communicate and take care of, dissolve whatever is the disharmonious issues, and the spouse is not willing, then how does she sort of handle that and let it not affect her child?
Yeah, so I think it's very difficult to take a drastic step and tell the spouse to do something. But as I said, the Sunday exercise where you just say, okay, let's just sit and talk on Sunday. That very often the spouses agree, very often. And all that is needed is just that one step to start the process of communication. It goes a long way. Expression of anger is a very important part of any communication. So how do you express anger is something which you need to understand very clearly. Do you bottle it up and turn it inwards and then it explodes later at some point of time? Or the moment you are angry, you explode. You react. You are nasty. You are mean. What do you do? What is your method of expressing anger? That's one thing which all of us need to take a look at, personally, professionally, in every way. So if you feel that your anger is destructive and it's really spoiling things, then you need to take a look at the cause of anger and cut ties with anger and all the other cuts related to it. Any questions around that? Yeah.
I've been telling my husband for the very past 3 years that he should do the cutting, start the cutting ties process. But he says, yeah, whatever you're saying is nice. He listens to Sir's talks also. I forward it to make him listen, but he is not yet started of what could he do.
Because so he'll start whenever his time children. Is ready. He'll start whenever he's ready.
Okay.
He'll start whenever he's ready.
He gets angry very often. I realize that children are seeing and they might get affected with that.
Have you cut ties with effect of his anger on you?
No, I've not done that.
Yeah. Okay. So if supposing, let's say somebody in the family is a very angry person, you have to cut ties with effect of that person's anger on you.
Okay.
That's very important because anger does create negativity. It does hurt everybody. So effect of the other person's anger on you is very important. And the kids, as they grow up, you can teach them the cutting ties work. Yeah.
Thank you.
So what's the right way of expressing
anger? There will be a lot of reasons why you are angry, dissatisfied, resentful. So the best way is to sit down and talk to the person about it. That this is the reason I'm angry with you and this is how I feel. So the idea is to express what is in you but in an even tone without getting emotional. But for that you will have to wait for your anger to subside. At that moment when you are caught in that emotion, the best way is to avoid expression. So whether you take a glass of water, you go for a walk, come back, feel better and tell him, I would like to talk to you about this and this is, I'm really furious about this. And very often in couples it's found that, let's say in couples or in siblings or parents and children, let's say I have a particular habit of criticizing or pointing out something which my child or husband may not like. Can I be that sensitive enough? If he tells me, look, I don't like this when you're telling me about this in this way, can I be sensitive enough not to repeat it in future? Or will I say, no, this is what I feel, this is what you should be doing, and this is how you should do it? So can we change ourselves a little bit if the other person is feeling hurt about our expression of anger? It's something we need to take a look at.
Sairam, I would like to know about this cutting ties of karma. What is it and how to affect it?
So whenever we are born in a family, obviously it is because of a previous karma that we have all taken birth together to sort out or balance the karma. So ideal would be to cut the ties of karma with each family member, with parents, with siblings, with children who have crossed puberty, but hold on for the spouse. Just wait. It's a symbol cut.
This is a symbol cut.
This is a symbol cut. Okay. And very often, some of us feel stuck in our so-called journey on the path. So if you feel stuck at any point of time, then maybe you could take a look at that. And this belief that you are stuck, you can cut ties with that if you believe that you are stuck. So believe
spiritual path.
If some people feel that, there are times when we are on the spiritual path and you reach a plateau. So there are times when you feel stuck and you really don't know whether you're moving forward, not moving forward, where you are not. So if you feel that way, then with that belief that I am stuck, you can cut ties with that.
For the belief, we have to have a symbol then.
These are all symbol cuts. Symbols. Yes. Relationship cuts are over. All of you have already done your primary cuts. Those are over. These are all symbol cuts.
So 2 weeks, 3 weeks?
The symbol cut now is 4 weeks.
4 weeks.
Yes. And for people who are affected by betrayal at workplace or home or infidelity, they need to cut ties with the effect of that other person's betrayal or infidelity on them. That's one thing which we all need to take a look at, because betrayal and infidelity lead to issues of trust. So if you find it difficult to trust other people in life, then you need to take a look at that. And if you're not able to understand why you're not able to trust others, then just cut ties with the root cause of my inability to trust others and its effect on me. So even if it's anger of other people, if it's fear of other people, very overpowering and overwhelming fear, then you can cut ties with the effect of that on you. And for some of us who have members at home who are very angry people, there is one exercise, it's called the anger container, where you imagine when the other person is angry, you imagine that between you and the other person, there is a huge vessel in between both of you. Could be like a bucket or a huge vessel or whatever you're comfortable with, made of any metal or whatever it is. And when the person is angry, imagine that he or she is pouring all their anger into the vessel, and you are not affected by it. Net result is that you don't take it personally. So when you kind of feel that the person is pouring all the anger into the container, bas, that's it. The anger is no longer directed at you. You are not affected by it and it doesn't bother you. And of course, you have to do the cut effect of the other person's anger on you. That cut is also to be done.
Is angry with the other person, and I'm also there the anger is not on me, but the whole situation is affecting me.
That's fine. So effect of the other person's anger on you is the cut to be done.
It's not on me. Like, the person is not angry at me.
That doesn't matter.
Okay.
The person may be an angry person, may be angry at a colleague also, but it's bothering you. So effect of that person's anger on you need not be directed at you.
Okay.
So that cut has to be done. And the other is, there's no harm in imagining an anger container and imagine that he's dumping his anger into that. So it doesn't affect you. That really helps tremendously. It's a very instant kind of an exercise if you're able to remember it.
At that moment only?
At that moment when he or she is angry.
If you can share more about how to deal with the addictions. So if there's a family member who is addicted to something, then how does one deal with it?
So Phyllis always spoke about alcohol addiction, drug addiction. She spoke about addiction to pornography. She spoke about addiction to sex also, and many different things. Since we cannot change the other person, what you can do is cut ties with the effect of the other person's addiction on you. So let us say the other person is addicted to alcoholism or drug or any of the other things, then you cut ties with the other person's addiction to --- on you. Could be addiction to gambling also, could be any kind of addiction, could be a major or a minor addiction, but if it's bothering you, then you definitely need to cut ties with it, and this will definitely be more than 4 weeks. It will go up to 6 to 8 weeks.
The same thing holds good if there is an illness,
right?
If someone in the family is ill.
So sickness is and dealing with health and sickness is another very important family atmosphere. So we all come from different families where we have learned how to deal with health and sickness in different ways. So for example, if there is one person, when he or she is ill, they go, they just take medicines, they are quiet, and they allow themselves to heal. Some people throw a huge tantrum, they want a lot of attention, they want everybody in the house to be pampering them, running errands for them, and everybody's attention should be focused on them. Okay, that's another method. This they have obviously copied from some parent, from one of the parents or grandparents. There are some people who withdraw. They like kind of go into a corner, they don't want to talk to anybody, they don't want anybody to disturb them, they would like time to heal by themselves. There are some people who use sickness to blackmail other people and control other people in the family. For example, an elderly grandparent who feels that they have lost control over children and grandchildren's lives. So when a sickness happens, they would like to use that to control everybody and make everybody listen to them. So they will be in bed, they will be in sick, but they will be controlling everybody. What everybody is doing, saying, wearing, thinking, everything. So the best way to handle this is to cut the ties of that person's illness on you. Cutting ties with that particular person's illness on you. And in fact, this can be a trauma. If it's a trauma, then you need to cut ties with the trauma of this person's illness and its effect on you.
So, when we cut ties with the other person's addiction on us,
effect of his
effect, will it help the other person also to improve from that addiction, or it's only protecting us from that effect?
So it will help you to handle that better. It will help you not to be impacted the way you used to be impacted earlier.
Okay.
But since we are all interconnected at the subconscious level, there may be a change in the other person. Any questions, or should I move ahead to roles and Babushka?
Yeah, there's this, like the effect when we are cutting,
the effect of other person's behavior. So can we put many persons into the circle, or?
It's always one person at a time.
It's always one person.
It's always one person at a time.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
So one is, let's say it's a colleague at workplace. So first you need to cut ties with that colleague. And then with the effect of his behavior on you. So first it will be a relationship cut and then a symbol cut.
So it should be only for one person?
One person at a time. To ask something? Okay, so we move ahead to roles. So every child who is born into a family, in order to get love and attention from the parents, immediately the child starts playing a role. If it finds that the mother is not coming to give milk in time, some kids start yelling, screaming, shouting. And if they find that it's only after yelling and screaming and shouting that the mother is responding, so the child grows up to be a tantrum thrower. The child plays the role of a tantrum thrower in order to get love and attention from the mother or father. Some kids who ask for milk and scream for milk, when they don't get milk, they withdraw. And the child grows up to be into a withdrawn child, maybe also becomes an introverted child. Some kids, as they are growing up, when they find that whenever the child does something good, the parents pat it on the back and say, oh, what a good boy and what a good girl. The child learns that in order to win this appreciation and love and attention from my parents, I have to be a good boy or a good girl and always do nice things. So the child learns to be a people pleaser. And people pleasers can never say no to anybody. So what happens? So these are just three roles I have outlined. We play about a dozen different roles. These roles serve us as long as we are children, because they are needed for our survival in the family. But when we grow up to become adults, if we carry these roles into adulthood, it doesn't help us. So we find, particularly whether it's a man or a woman, if they are a people pleaser, when they get into marriage, they get walked all over. They become like a doormat, because they can't say no to spouse, they can't say no to in-laws, they can't say no to children. So everybody has their way with them, and these people are not able to say no. Phyllis said it's very important for us to understand that we are not our role. We are much beyond our role, and we need to drop these roles which no longer serve us. So you need to understand what kind of role you are playing. Most of us play 3-4 different roles as a child. So have you identified the role? You need to identify the role. And then, after identifying the role, you need to imagine each role on a balloon. This is called the balloon, the exercise. So let's say you've played the role of a withdrawn child or a people pleaser, and 2-3 roles combined together. You imagine the face of each of this on a balloon. And you imagine that balloon is attached to some part of your body with a cord. Ask the high C to which part of your body these balloons are attached. And then you do the figure of eight with these balloons for about 2 weeks. And then the cut comes along. It's a different kind of a cut. So Shivani and Shaguna can help you with that. But the idea is to imagine each face of that. Supposing it's a people pleaser, you can imagine yourself as a child who's a people pleaser on one balloon. And if you are comfortable, supposing there are only 2 roles, maybe you can imagine both the roles on one balloon on either side. It's up to you. Ask the high C and then take a look at what role. But identifying roles is very important. sometimes we play certain roles even in adulthood which we have not taken up in childhood. One of the roles is that of a conciliator. This some people play in childhood. For example, if parents are constantly fighting, the child tries to patch both of them up, tries to create peace at home. If you have not done this as a child and you're doing this at office, at workplace, maybe you're playing the role of a conciliator now, which may or may not be required. You need to take a look at that. So a certain basic idea is first cut roles with the childhood roles which you have, cut ties with the childhood roles you have played, and then let's see later what roles you're playing in adulthood. Any questions on this? So, a rebellious child, a withdrawn child, a tantrum thrower, a people pleaser. Generally, these are the four main roles that we play. One is the role of a doormat. One is the role of a controller who would like to control every situation. So, controller and doormat are also two very important roles. By and large, these six roles should be enough. Yeah. No, those are very valid questions. That would be ideal. But if there are, let's say, just two roles which you have been able to identify and you're comfortable putting both on either side of one balloon, you can do that.
So when we do the cutting, is it all the roles into one?
Or one when we do the cutting, it's all the roles in one. We cut ties with all roles together.
How? Like when you do a simple...
Yes, so Abhi, I would suggest that start with the figure of eight. Mm-hmm. Then we'll come to the cut later. Yeah. Cut procedure is very different from a relationship or a symbol cut. Yeah. Not roll, we'll be doing a symbol cut today.
Yeah.
Any roles you all can point out? Role of a victim, yeah. But that may or may not be a childhood role. It may be an adult role, yeah.
Adult role, one who is always right.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Yeah. Then the one who criticizes.
Yes.
One who doubts.
One who judges.
Judges, yeah.
Role of the doubter. Role of the doubter, yes. These are adult roles.
Rebel without a cause.
That's a childhood role. That's an adult role. Hmm. Yeah.
I think Krista had mentioned about the crown prince.
Yes. So there was a story where you had one girl amongst 6-7 brothers, the youngest child amongst 6-7 brothers. So she was always, these are other roles. The role of the oldest child in the family. And the role of the middle child in the family and the role of the youngest child in the family. So the oldest child always becomes a caretaker, usually. So we call it the role of the caretaker. So you need to take a look at what role you were playing. Were you playing the role of the older daughter or son in the family? And were always in the habit of taking care of everything. And later on, it was expected of you that you will take care of everything. Then the role of the youngest child, the one who is always pampered and who things are done for that particular child automatically. So one example which was given was a girl with 6-7 older brothers, and she was so pampered that later on when she got married, she expected the same from her husband, and her marriage did not work out because obviously she would not get pampered that way. So it ended in a divorce. So exactly. Yeah. So there was a total conflict of roles. So these roles can really play havoc if we are not aware of them.
So why is it wrong for a person to create peace? Like if it's not something.
it's not wrong. The intention is absolutely good. But if you have made it a habit into being a conciliator always, then it starts stressing you out after a point of time. So if it is bothering you, see, all these roles need to be looked at only if it is bothering you. If it's not bothering you and you're very comfortable playing that, it's fine. Each of these things, everything which is pointed out in the cutting ties work, these are things to help you be more self-aware and understand what's bothering you. If certain things are there, yes, it's there, but it's not bothering you, then it's fine. Like, there are children who play the role of a conciliator between parents, and over a period of time they get absolutely fed up and tired of playing the role of a conciliator and always trying to make peace between parents. And when they grow up, they just don't want to play that role anymore of trying to be a conciliator anymore. So if they're fed up and they've reached that stage, then they definitely need to cut ties with it. Anything else about roles?
Should we first see what is bothering me at this moment, and does this map to something, some role in the childhood? I'm not very clear about finding, is that correct?
Yeah. So take a look at, like, since we are already identifying the roles, take a look at whether you played any of these roles. That'll help you. If you haven't, it's fine.
Yeah, but I think almost, I mean, everybody will have one role at least that we would have.
Yeah. So take a look at whether in your expression, are you a withdrawn child even today? Are you a rebel? Are you a tantrum thrower? Are you a people pleaser?
Wanting to do the right thing always, will it fall into the people pleaser or what is
it? No. Where does it come from? Are you afraid of making mistakes?
No, just wanting to be right. I mean, always. I think that is pressure. I mean,
so
never to get angry at all, never to get irritated at all.
Are you very demanding of yourself? Are you expecting a lot from yourself? Have you set very high standards for your own behavior and self-judgmental? Yeah, but setting very high standards for yourself, being very hard on yourself, where you don't give any scope for yourself to make mistakes. And you're angry with yourself when you make mistakes.
Yeah, upset at least, if not angry.
Right. So does that come from a childhood where your family would be annoyed with you for making mistakes?
No.
Take a look at that, because we copy our parents. The way our parents deal with us, we deal with ourselves the same way. The way our parents treat us, we treat ourselves the same. So if our parents treat us with even a little bit of criticism or judgmentalism, we become critical and judgmental about ourselves. So usually this being very hard on ourselves stems back from a family which was hard on us. So take a look at, I mean, it could be a mild, on a scale of 1 to 10, it need not be 10. It could be 1, 2 or 3 also. But take a look at that. So then you'll have to cut ties with your parents' habit of being like that with you, and your habit of being very hard on yourself, and your expectations of yourself. It boils down to expectations. So what were the expectations of your family as far as you were concerned? Did they expect you to be a perfect child? If they expected you to be a perfect child today, do you expect yourself to be a perfect woman, a perfect mother, a perfect wife? So does this boil down to your expectations? So yes, expectations is a major area where we all need to cut ties with expectations of our family of us, expectations of our spouse, expectations of society, our own expectations of ourselves.
So what would be the childhood role for this, expectations of the family on you?
It may not be a role, it's just expectations of family on you. It's just a cut pertaining to expectation of my mother of me, expectation of my father of me. It can be a double cut.
Okay.
because it's the same subject, so you could do a double cut at the same time.
So being an obedient child or a responsible child could also be roles, right? Childhood roles.
Yes.
So maybe you could look at that, Sarvani, if you were an obedient child.
Obedient child. Yeah. Or a people pleaser. If you're not able to say no, then that's definitely a people pleaser.
Yeah.
Obedient child, and then also the oldest child?
Oldest child.
Yes.
Oldest,
so that's a,
yes.
So you're playing the role of a caretaker. Yeah.
So the oldest children are supposed to teach the...
No, take care.
Take care and also set example, you know. She used to put us in buses, push us in buses, push us out of buses.
Yeah. Any questions on that? Yeah. Balvikas came much later. Balvikas comes much later. The seeds are sown much before that. Balvikas comes later. That's only very late.
Always wanting to do the right thing or whatever, this is not the right way to do.
Self-critical. Have you cut ties with being self-critical? Yeah. So, self-criticism, self-judgmentalism, all these are ties which need to be cut. Yeah. And expectations is a very big thing. That is a must for all of us. Because so many people expect so much from us, we need to cut ties with that. And our own expectations of ourselves is the biggest one.
Supposing if we have terminated a child, when we conceive, what type of cut is required and what type of trauma that it will affect us?
Yeah, so Phyllis mentioned in one place that you need to cut ties with the unborn child.
Unborn.
And second is the ties with guilt. You need to do the guilt suit. If you have not done it already, you need to do the guilt suit. Yeah, these two would be enough for that. We move on to the next one. Okay, so the next one is the babushka. It is called the Russian nest of dolls, where if you remember, there's one doll inside another and there are 6-7 layers. So Phyllis used this symbol to help us understand the layers of conditioning which are imposed on us since childhood. So she said that when we are all growing up in a family, she gave a very good example. She said that whatever our parents tell us about ourselves, the negative programming or the negative conditioning which is done to us, we make that come true. We play that out in our lives. So for example, she gave the example of two sisters. One was the older sister was fairer and prettier, and the younger one was darker. So the parents always told the older one that you're so pretty, you're going to get a very good husband and you're going to be very successful in life. And the younger one was told, "Arey, look at you, your looks are really less than average. You're never going to make a good marriage and I don't think you're so intelligent and so successful. You're never going to be so successful in life." As the older sister, as the sisters grew up, the older one, exactly as the parents said, she took up a very good career and she made a very good marriage. And the younger one married a school teacher who was not earning much and she could not make a career. So Phyllis described this story to prove the point that we play out the negative programming and the negative conditioning which our parents impose on us since childhood. So the idea is that can we remember or try to remember the negative sentences which were often repeated by our parents to us. You are like this, you are like that. You can never do this, you can never do that. For example, in a family of singers, I came across one girl, others used to sing very well in the family. She wanted to sing too, she loved singing. But her parents told us, no, you are completely out of tune, you will never make a good singer. She actually never took up singing because her parents told us, you can't make a good singer. Whereas everybody else in the family sang very well. So she was very affected by what her parents said, because a child believes what the parents tell it about itself. And when you believe that, you make that happen, you make that come true. It's called you're playing out your conditioning. So can you be more aware about how you were conditioned as a child, and can you then deal with it? So the way of doing it is trying to identify the oft repeated sentences, negative sentences, which your parents told you about yourself. And if there are 4-5 different sentences, you imagine each of this in as one doll in the set of babushka. And you cut ties with it for 4 to 6 weeks. And then that's also a different kind of a cut. So Shivani and Shaguna will take you through it once you all start that. And then the cut can be done. But it's very important to understand what kind of sentences were repeated to you about your looks, your intelligence, your abilities, your future. Whether your parents said that you're not intelligent enough, you're good only to be married, so you better get married because you can't do anything else in life. What were the kind of sentences that your parents told you? Destiny, as in whether you are choosing to. It was conditioning. So the whole issue of destiny and choice is a very big subject, no? So in the Phyllis Crystal work, we take responsibility for our lives. We take responsibility for the choices we make, for our journey into self-awareness. And that's a choice.
So in the second case, if she's destined to be a school teacher and leading a simple life, with a choice, can she change?
If it's a conditioning, definitely it can be changed, 100%.
Thank you.
You asked us to look at the sentences that were told, right? So is it only during the childhood, or is it even now what the parents tell us on this?
So what happens is they don't say anything new now. Usually. Right? It's not something new which has come out now. It's something which starts from childhood only. So.
Not affected by those negative sentences. What I'm affected by is when I see a parent doing it on a child. Now what do I do?
So it's triggering off a memory somewhere. And if anything which happens around you, if it's affecting you, you need to see what needs to be resolved in you. If violence, anger, fear, anything which is affecting you, then
it's not violence. Anger, it's sadness. So when I tell the person, don't do it, because the person will get affected and they will believe what you say. But I'm not able to correct the situation.
Right, so you don't have to correct the situation. So you said a very important word, that's sadness. So it's triggering off a memory of sadness in you. Somewhere because you experienced the same thing, though you were not affected by it, and you consciously believe you were not affected by it. Subconsciously, one still doesn't know. So I would suggest that still take a look at the sentences. It's always good to do the babushka and then cut ties with the sadness at your parents' conditioning or behavior and its effect on you. Yeah, cutting ties with sadness at different things which have happened in your life is very important. Yeah, there may be some incidents or so many things which have happened in our life which you have gotten over and it no longer bothers you, but once in a while it'll pinch you. Once in a while you feel sad about it, so you need to cut ties with sadness of around that incident and its effect on you.
Is it wrong to feel sad for the situation?
No.
Like as she
says, sadness and empathy, there are two different things. If you're empathizing with the person and you feel that person's, you know, pain, that's different. But if you're feeling sad, then there's something in you which you need to revolve or to resolve. Yeah. So that's it about babushka. Any doubts on babushka?
So in my case, although I was the younger child in the family, I grew up being the more responsible or sort of expecting to be sort of independent and on my own.
Right.
So I've played out the role of an elder
child. Elder child.
Yeah, although I was the younger child. So
right.
That is still a role that
right.
is
right. Do you still play that role?
Yes.
Where you take care of things wherever
yes.
you go, in office, at a picnic, everywhere
yes.
you take care? Yeah, so that is a role you have to cut ties with.
So it sort of goes overboard at times. I've realized that I've had people pointing it out to me that in situations where it's not required, also I go overboard and then.
And it stresses you out.
Yes.
Yeah.
If we are not aware of those roles, can we put just the babushka in the figure eight and cut with it?
No, you mean you're not aware of the conditioning? Conditioning? No. Because when you're not aware of the conditioning and you're not able to zero in, then there's no point in putting the babushka because the babushka will be all empty.
Mm-hmm. No, but Krista had mentioned this. She said even if you're not aware, just go ahead and do it.
But how will you do it? Each of these dolls
you
will be empty.
So you kind of destroy each of the layers.
What do they indicate?
No, she said just do it like as is, as because the symbol itself will take care and the high C will guide.
Okay, so let me verify with her. Fir I'll get back to you. Okay, so now the house is open for any question on any part of cutting ties. Yeah.
It's not about cutting ties, but I have about my son. I just noticed this kind of behavior recently. He's only 5 years old. But if I tell him, don't do, this is not correct, don't do that, he'll say, okay, hit me. Like that he does, and then he will say, okay, now I'm going out of the, I'm not your family. I feel like they're such very big words for that small child to say and have fear that it's something that is something to do with the past that is coming forth in him or is something to do with us. Not able to understand.
So he feels very bad that he has made a mistake.
I don't even scream also at him.
No. So when he says hit me, he's feeling bad that he made a mistake. Is that how it is?
But after some time, if I try to ignore him, then he does his own work. Is it some kind of trying to grab my attention or?
So the age of 5 is the age when the child is exploring several behaviors with the parent. What he can get away with. So you just have to watch now. There will be certain things he will push his limit with you to see what he can get away with and what is acceptable to you and not acceptable. What is not acceptable, he will draw the line. Just watch for some time. Yeah.
Okay.
Charu, I had a question on the babushka. So is there another way of doing it? One way is looking at the sentences that were told to you. Is there another way of doing it? And what to put in each?
There could be some memories about certain incidents where something nasty really happened or really was said to you. Again, relating around what your parents said to you and what happened in that situation. Yeah. Okay. Which has affected you very deeply. What they made you feel at that point of time. Which affected your self-esteem or the way you look at yourself or your own self-image and all this.
It has to be related to one role, the dolls, or it can be...
Dolls is not role.
No. So it has to be one impact or it has to be...
No, it can be... there's no subject in that as such, but it can be a few negative things said or done or negative things about 4 or 5 different things, all pertaining to your self-image, your self-esteem, and your own idea about who you are.
And that clarifies it.
I hope you all have taken a look at the issues of lack of self-esteem, a low self-image, a lack of self-confidence. These are 4 or 5 different cuts which are related. So one is a low self-image, one is a lack of self-esteem, one is a lack of self-confidence. You have to cut with these, if it is a problem, but they are usually related. Yeah. Any other question?
Some examples of roles in babushka you can give.
They're not roles.
No, examples of the conditioning. Say, for example, I am not good enough. Does that come from something the parents said to you, that you are not good enough? That's one example.
That's what conditioning can be, about anything which the parents negatively programmed you for. It's a negative programming, a negative conditioning. It doesn't have to be related. One can be about good looks, one can be about capacity, capability, you are like this, you are like that, anything. Yeah.
Until which age is this relevant? Because we keep telling us that it's more to do with the childhood.
So, I think till puberty is, because puberty is a very important time in the cutting ties work. So till puberty is what we can take a look at. Beyond puberty, generally that's a very sensitive age, up to 18, 19, till you become an adult. So then the remaining become adult conditioning or adult role. Sometimes conditioning also happens at the workplace, but we come to that later. Let's not get into that.
So actually, few of the people actually spoke about various roles, you know, where they are anxious, something like that. So, like, is there anything also related to, like, people who are very chilled out? Like, you know...
Is that a problem?
Yeah, because it's like, okay, it'll happen when it'll happen, you know, I don't care. You know, care means... What attitude?
So, is that a revolt against a family atmosphere where everybody was anxious? So if chilled out, see, it's good to be cool, but if one is too cool and really doesn't give attention and value to things when they have to be given attention to, then it's a problem, right? So then is the child revolting against a very anxious kind of a atmosphere or habit of a parent who was very anxious and stressed out?
No, so it's more about this, though I will manage. You know, I'll take care of it, it'll not go out of hand.
Okay. So
I'll
if
manage it off somehow.
If they're able to manage, then it's fine.
So that's not a habit, something.
No, if they feel that I'll be able to manage and they're able to manage, it's fine. But if they feel they're able to they will be able to manage and they never manage it, then it's a problem.
How about if it is 50-50?
After?
And sometimes, you know, we've feel like able to manage.
It's good to take a look at the family atmosphere. Okay. And it's good to take a look at the habits of the parents and to check whether there was a rebellion against one of the parents or not.
Okay. I probably have a thought on it.
Yeah. All right. Should we go for the cut now? So, if there is something common which all of you want to cut ties with, we were just discussing before all of you came in yeah, sure.
Can you please talk a little about archetypes? There's always a gray area there.
Maybe next session, Swami. Next session.
Please, today
it will become a little too much with roles and babushka because the group has not finished roles and babushka yet, Swami. Archetypes will be too much today. Next time. Definitely.
Put a date.
Yeah. I'll come back.
In terms of the negative statements of the parents, if it somehow leads to the child trying to sort of counteract it, like if the parent said that you'll end up being a spendthrift, and if the child's whole life is to try to prove that, no, I am conscious on money, does it still come in the same category?
So the child either copies or revolts.
Right.
So for everything which you are able to identify in a parent, you have to check whether you copied or revolted. Because both are extremes and you need to center yourself. So if the parent is a spendthrift and the child became a miser, it's a revolt, or vice versa. So it's that's why there are different family atmospheres. About time, for example, a parent asking the child to get up early every day to go to school. The parent is normally doing his or her job. But the child hates being woken up in the morning and being pushed to school. So the child revolts and is never punctual. Okay, so vice versa. So similarly, you have issues about food. Also, the parent wanting the child to eat healthy food, the child revolts and goes on to junk food. So there are different things. So what have you done? Copied or revolted? And if you've revolted, you need to cut ties with it. If you've copied, you need to cut ties with it.
Would it still come in the babushka thing?
No, this is copying or revolting. Yeah,
it
will be a separate cut. There are several of them, no? 8-10 of them, yeah.
Charu, in the babushka exercise, so each negative sentence that has had an effect on you, would that be denoted by each doll?
Each doll.
Okay.
So if there are 4, 5, 6 layers, you can put one sentence for each doll, and then imagine that doll, repeat all the sentences to yourself, put that doll in the figure of 8, and run the figure of 8 for 4 to 6 weeks.
Okay.